Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father in heaven, we thank you for giving us this beautiful place to gather. We thank you for everyone who's listening this morning, Lord, and we pray, Lord, you reveal yourself to us. Lord, you love us so much. You sent your son to die for us. Lord, and as Christmas time approaches, Lord, we just pray that you would help us to remember your great love for us, the greatest gift ever given, Lord, and the word that testifies of that, and that life and that sacrifice. Lord, help us to be clay in the potter's hands. Lord, may you mold us and shape us, encourage us for this coming week, Lord, that we would walk away changed from this time with you. And Lord, we just pray you use Pastor Izzy now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen.
Well, guys, I want to encourage you to keep praying for our brother Holland and Stephanie that went off to Vegas. And Miss Holland, he's the voice on the beginning of the radio show. You'll hear him come on and invite people to join in and listen and look up stuff on the web. You know, if you want more info, go look at the AmazingGraceKona.com. And if you didn't get one of the church pens, we just had some pens made up last week, and so they're really cool. And they have the website address on there and the P.O. box and the number of the church. So sometimes, you know, people, you give them a bulletin, and they're like, but if you give them a pen, they're like, well, I could use this, you know. And then later, it'll just be right there on the side, you know, saying the thing. So that's a great way to let your relatives know about. If you say, look, we really sit on a beach, you can click the link right from the website to YouTube and watch the videos, and you can see this wallpaper. And for those of you guys, when you're gone, you know, and you're just missing out, or you're on the mainland visiting someone, you can show them, hey, this is our church on the beach, and all these little cameras take great shots behind me. So I'm waiting for the whales to show up during the sermon. I know it's a really nice touch, and they were here last week when we did Steve Hudson's memorial up at Hapuna. We were having a meal afterwards, and two whales started breaching during that. That was my first two whales I saw this season, so I know they're here. So if by chance, while I'm sharing the word, a whale jumps behind me, please point so I can turn around. I can preach this way, and it won't bother me. And I'll get to, I'm from Arizona, man. It's still a cool thing to see whales, you know. I mean, it's just neat to see God's handiwork. So we remember, disclaimer, we don't worship whales. We worship the maker of the whales. So, but he's an awesome creator. And, you know, his creation, it says all of his creation testifies to the glory of the Lord. Just seeing all the stuff that is made. You know, when you, I don't know about you, when I'm outside and I see just the things of nature, what God has made, I think, you are a great creator. I mean, just the way you made these little bees to interact with this flower and pollinate that one, and, you know, all those little connections that he put together, those all had to be put together, if you study it, at the same time. Because without it, they're like connected. The one bee can't survive without that other flower, and the Lord, he did all those little things that the scientists say evolved over millions and billions of years. Which we know God just said, no, I spoke it and made it by the power of my word. And so it takes for me more faith to believe in evolution than it does to believe in God. Because evolution has a lot of holes in it. And by the way, it's called the theory of evolution. You guys do know it's not called the fact of evolution. It's called the theory. And the theory has to be proven. So I'm a science kind of, you know, geek type guy. I love to learn stuff. But I don't like when they push stuff down my throat that doesn't line up with God's word. Now today we're going to look into God's word, and we're going to be at a part in Romans. What I shared last week is one of the most freeing parts for my soul. In fact, I am so grateful for the Apostle Paul that he put this part in the Bible, because we're going to come to the part where Paul, he reviews something that I don't know if any of you have ever had this happen, where he's going to be going over the very thing he says that I don't want to do, I find myself doing. And the very thing I wished I would do, I don't do. Now, has anyone ever experienced this in your life's travels where you're like, purposing in your heart, I am not going to do that bad thing, and I'm only going to do the good thing. I'm going to start eating a good, clean diet, and I'm not going to eat the junk food. And then you go to the party at Tori's house, and what are they having? And I'm just talking because Tori and Dave had us over last night, a whole bunch of people. And I was there. I saw a lady, Barbara, that was there last year, and we both commiserated together because both of us can't have dairy, and we can't have gluten. Do you know how much food comes to parties that's made out of wheat, flour, and you know, cheese and dairy, and oh my gosh, the platters, and I'm just looking in my, I'm drooling, you know, and this lady Barb, she said, last year we were like, she's like, I'm gonna eat clean, and I said, okay, me too, because you know, if I don't, I'm gonna pay for it anyway. I'm gonna be all stuffed up, and the next day, and hurting, and my joints hurt worse, and she's like, I'm not gonna do it, And last year we both pulled it off. We picked everything that was on our diet off the bar and just ate that, and it still was great. I mean, there was plenty of food to get away with that. But this year I was doing it, and she said I slipped. There was just too much good stuff. She goes, I'm gonna pay for this for the next couple of days, and it's funny how she goes, we were talking about this, weren't we? And I was like, yep, I remember. We were this exact conversation came up. And it's hard because when you're at a party that's, you know, all the stuff's there. And you can – have any of you ever done that? You purposed in your heart, I'm not going to eat the junk because I don't feel good when I do. But then it happens to be the only thing on the table. Or maybe it's not the only thing, but it's the only thing crying to you. Eat me, you know. And you're just like, oh, it's just the coconut shrimp. She's not supposed to eat coconut, but coconut shrimp, I would go down too. It's just one of those things, you know. We struggle with this. Now I'm so grateful for this chapter of the Bible. In fact, for your just note takers, just remember this: Romans 7:14, where we're gonna pick up today, is the part of the Bible what I refer to this last half of Romans 7 as what I call the doo-doo chapter. You know, the very things I don't want to do, I do do, and the very things I do don't want to, wait, no, that, the ones I do want to do, I don't do, right? It's all doo-doo. I mean, it's just, spiritually, it's a quagmire that I think every person at some point in their life's journey is going to run into this problem. And so I'm grateful for the words, what Paul shares. They're freeing words. Let me read it to you. It says here in Romans 7:14. He says, for we know the law is spiritual. He says, but I am of the flesh, sold into the bondage of sin. Now, he says, for what I am doing, I do not understand. For I'm not practicing what I would like to do. He says, but I'm doing the very thing I hate. He says, but if I do the very thing I do not want to do, I agree with the law, confessing that the law is good. You know, the law pointed out all the sin. And Paul's like, when I do that stuff that the law says I shouldn't do, you know, when God's law says, thou shalt not covet. Paul said last week, it produced in him every kind of coveting, you know. He's like, as soon as you said, don't do it, he realized inside of him there was something wired in him that wanted to do what he was told not to do. Now, none of you ever do that. Last week we titled the YouTube thing, Do Not Walk on the Grass, right? Don't walk on the grass, because as soon as someone says, don't do it, what do? Challenge accepted. Stomp on that little grass. You know, we just are wired. We don't like someone tells not to do. And Paul says, this is what he discovered, that the law, he said, it's good. But where's the problem? Inside him, he said. Inside us. He said, I found out that there's this thing inside me wants to do the wrong thing. So then, he said, verse 17. Now listen to this part. So then, no longer am I the one doing it, but he said, but it is the sin which dwells in me. Now this is not hard for me to understand. I mean, not to accept. I grew up in a Catholic upbringing. We were taught we were sinners from really early on, because every week we had to go to confessional, and we had to confess weekly, go in the box with the priest. I don't know, has anyone of you had this as an experience where you went in and visit the priest, and you confess, Father, forgive me, for I have what? Sinned. And then you confess the sins that you did, and then he gives you the prayers of penance that you're going to go do before you, you know, when you go the next day and take communion, you're going to go kneel down and pray these prayers and do so many Our Father, so many Hail Marys. I knew I was the worst sinner in the whole church because everyone else sat up back in the pew. You know, you were supposed to kneel down while you were praying after you had the sacrament, and you'd be kneeling down, and then everyone would slide back up into their seat when they were done with their prayers. And I was still on my knees. And the rest of the church is all seated, waiting. And I'm praying as fast as I can. Our Father, Hail Mary, full of grace. And I was going, like, I'm like, what? They must not sin. But as far as me knowing I sinned, I knew that I sinned. That was never a problem. It's what do I do about it? What do I do about it? And so Paul says, I discovered that the law, when it said don't do it, something inside me wanted to break the law. And he identifies what it is. He says, it's sin. You know, in counseling, counselors will tell people, look, we can't help you until you're willing to first accept or confess that you have a problem. I mean, if you can't acknowledge that you got something to work on, first step of dealing with someone in counseling is, look, you have to say, basically own it. Whatever it is that you're struggling, if you're addicted to alcohol, you just got to call it like it is. I'm addicted to alcohol. If you're not willing to say that, what's the counselor do? Sorry, no, I can't help you. We can't move forward until we're willing to own what it is the problem. Does Paul own his problem right here? Does he say, I found out inside me there is what present? Sin. He didn't go, yeah, there's sin in all those other people, not me. That's like those holier-than-thou people you see running around in some church circles. You know, I call them the pharisaical Christians. They're like the Pharisees of the days of Jesus, but they're in Christianity today. And they're always pointing out other sin. God, I thank thee that I am not like that sinner over there. Remember the guy that stood up, Jesus said, on the corner of the temple? I thank thee that I am not like that sinner. And there was a man, it says, that was face down, throwing the dust of the earth over his head, saying, God, forgive me. I'm a sinner. I'm lower than the dirt. He was humbled himself, prostrate, at the other corner of the temple. And Jesus told this story. He said, the rich guy, the Pharisee, he stood up there going, I tithe of everything that I get. I honor you. I obey. I do everything. I'm not like that one. And what was Jesus' answer to them? He said, which one of those two went home justified in the sight of God? See, in God's sight, the guy who was humble and said, God, forgive me. I'm just a sinner. God says, I can work with that. But the guy who says, I don't have any problems. I'm perfect. You got a lot of problems. First of all, you're a liar. And that's just a start. We can work down from there. But you're deceived. Because we all have this. And I'm so glad Paul said it. He said, look, inside me there's sin. I got a problem. Listen to this. He says in verse 18, for I know that nothing good dwells in me. That is, in my flesh. Talking about his fleshly, carnal nature. So there's nothing good about it. What does the flesh always look after? Itself. It's very, very selfish. It's all me, 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 I, all about me. That's all the flesh does. Paul says, I know there's nothing good dwelling in my flesh. But he says, for the willing is present in me, but the doing of good is not. This is a big problem. One that I think a lot of people face. I know I do. He says, for the good that I want to do, I do not do, verse 19, but I practice the very evil that I don't want to do. He says, but if I am doing the very thing I do not want, then he said, I am no longer the one doing it, but it is sin that dwells in me. Let's put it to what it is. Let's call it, he's basically going, let's identify this for what it, if we're going to move forward, we got to start and identify the problem. What is the real problem? He said, it's sin. So he said, I find then this principle, that evil is present in me, the one that wants to do good. Can anyone identify with what he's saying? That even though you want to do good, there's that old evil nature that rears its ugly head sometimes. Only when you're overtired, a little bit low blood sugared. Everyone's pressing on you, asking for something, and you kind of start to snap a little. But you know, what is it, that part that comes out? Where does that come from? Why do we get like that? Because we still have that sin to deal with. And Paul, he says, listen to this. Verse 22, he says, I joyfully concur with God, with the law of God in the inner man. He says, but I see a different law in the member of my body. It wages war against the law of my mind, and it makes me prisoner of the law of sin, which is in my members. I still got this sin present in my members. It's a struggle. He said, wretched man that I am, who will set me free from this body of sin and death? Has anyone ever felt like that? Oh, God, would you just set me free from this sinful body? I mean, if I didn't have this sinful body, I wouldn't have so much trouble with sin, right? I mean, some of our biggest problems come from this carnal part of our being. And Paul says, oh, wretched man that I am. But then he says, verse 25, thanks be to God that through Jesus Christ our Lord, so then on the one hand, I myself, with my mind, I am serving the law of God. But on the other, with my flesh, the law of sin. Now, some people go, well, you sound bipolar, Paul. You know, on one side you serve God, on one side you don't. No, he's just identifying the problem. This sinful, wretched flesh that has sin DNA imprinted in it, well, we have to learn to live a life in after a different pursuit, after a different manner. And Paul is a master at laying a foundation. This is where they shouldn't have put a chapter break. At the end of chapter 7, there should be no end of this chapter right here. It should go right into chapter 8, verse 1. It's just something that the theologians put in later. It wasn't written in the original letter. The original letter just moved right along, right? Continue this thought. So that's what I want you to do with me today. Chapter 8, verse 1 reads, there is therefore now how much condemnation for those of us that are in Christ Jesus? How much? None. Zero. See, he's identified the problem, and the devil would say, well, see, you have sin. Right? The Bible says in Revelation, the devil goes before God, and he accuses the brethren day and night, saying, did you see Izzy? He's a sinner. And every time the devil accuses me before God, do you know what Jesus does? God the Father is the real judge. And Jesus stands up and says, it tells us in Hebrews, he is our advocate before the Father. Advocate means like a defense attorney. Objection, Your Honor. You know, Jesus stands up and goes, objection. Now, Satan's got me. He's going, he's a sinner. And Jesus goes, objection. And what's his objection? He says, I died for that. Already been paid for. And the Father says, overruled. Ping. Throw down throw it out. Next. And then he goes, well, but did you see Dave? And Jesus stands up again. Objection. Paid for that sin too. And every sin we committed, Christ paid for, didn't he? Says he took on all the sins of the world on himself, and he became what John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He came to take us away. But see, we're sitting there going, but I still got it. And the devil wants to condemn us over it. And Paul knew this. I think, by this point when he wrote the book of Romans, he had been pastoring for quite a while. And I think, when you pastor, there's these like what I call reoccurring themes that pop up. You know, the questions we get, like sometimes people come, they ask me these questions and I spin off the answer real quick and they're like, man, you really know this. No, it's only the 60th time this week, It's pretty, you're not the only one that has struggled with it. Like, it's not because I'm so smart, it's because you get to revisit it over and over and over. And people struggle. This is one of the ones people struggle with. I really didn't want to eat that chocolate cake. But it was calling to me. And I am allergic to gluten and dairy. And it had it, you know, it was with like a buttercream frosting. And I ate. And man, am I suffering for, and why did I, you know, and pastor, and I'm like, let me see, is sin still present within the members of my carnal body? No, this is, I mean, I've got some of you been in Christ. Who's been in Christ over 10 years? Raise your hand. Just curious. Okay, so that we're not talking about like a brand new Christian that just started out. Do Christians that have been in Christ for over a decade, do they still have this problem? Do we still have our flesh still trying to say, come on, eat the cake? And the spirit going, no, I don't want to with my mind. I know I shouldn't. Yes. And I'm really grateful for Paul that he does not minimize this and does not, exclude it. Because I would think I'm the only one messed up. I'm the only one that still struggles. And I mean, I've been in Christ over 30 years. So, you know, I'd be like, man, am I messed up, because it's been over 3 decades and I still have this daily struggle of this flesh. And the enemy would love to come along and say, you know, you should probably not call yourself a Christian. If you still struggle with that stuff after all this time, I mean, really, what kind of Christian are you? Maybe you should just quit. Do everyone a favor. Just quit that Jesus stuff. Just go eat the cake. Right? Doesn't the devil like to, his logic is just like, sometimes, and you know what the problem is? Sometimes when we're spiritually feeling a little weak, we fall for his stupid logic. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't go to church anymore. They probably don't want me there. I've blown it a few times. Listen, I got news for you. Everyone here has blown it. This is not welcome to the holiness club. This is welcome to the sinners club. I mean, by definition, to go to church, you have to be a sinner. It's like kind of should be over the door. Sinners welcome. Spiritual hospital for sinners. This is where the sick come. You know, really, that's what we are. It's a spiritual hospital. To go to Jesus, the doctor of our soul, to get well. And, well, Paul knew it. Paul was like, wretched man that I am. You know, I think today, Paul, if he was preaching, there'd be a lot of people going, he's not really in the politically correct, positive mindset thinking circle. You know, he's not going to make it with Zig Ziglar and, you know, some of the real good guys that are, they'd be like, he's a jerk. He says he's a sinner. He's a wretched man. I would have gone to his church, though. Seriously, if Paul was preaching, would you have gone? I'd be like, let me listen to this guy, because you know what? He's got it down. He actually knows the struggle. He knows the struggle is real, and he knows some things that we need to know. And listen, you might have friends that don't know what it says in chapter 8, verse 1, that there is therefore now how much condemnation? None. For those that are in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation for you. God knew that you have sin. God already took care of the problem. Now Paul is going to, this way you shouldn't, I think you shouldn't break chapter 7 and chapter 8. You should just go right on into the next thought, because the next thought is so freeing. Listen to what he says. He says, verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. There is a different law of the Spirit of life. It says, in Christ Jesus. There's a newness of life that Christ came to give us. And he says, that law sets us free from the law, the previous law of sin and death. He said, for what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin. And he condemns sin in the flesh. See, there's no condemnation for my sin because all of the sin was condemned by God when it was placed on Jesus. He paid the full price. It has been completely paid. Remember the last words of Christ on the cross before he gave up his spirit? He's hanging there. He said three words. It is what? We say in English, three words. It is finished. He was saying, I've done it. I have paid the price in full. And Jesus said, I did not come to abolish the law. He said, I came to what? Fulfill it. You know, the requirement of the law was that if there was sin, it had to be paid for. And the wages of sin was death. And it says the life was in the blood. So to pay for sin, this death, you had to pay with what? With blood. Blood had to be shed. That's why we sing all those hymns about the blood of the Lamb, you know. What can wash away my sin? What's the answer? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. See, what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. His blood was shed. That was the requirement of the law. He paid it. Done. Paid for. And now we have been invited to come follow him, and we get to serve now in a newness, a new law. This law is called the law of the spirit of life. I love that. This is pretty good. The law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Now, some of you need to learn this verse, okay? By the way, you might want to highlight that verse too, because you might run into this sect of Christianity that runs around today, and they say, we're Christians, but we adhere to the Old Testament law. And we worship on the Sabbath only, on Saturday. And you guys that worship on Sunday, you have taken the mark of the beast, and you are unholy, and God doesn't like you. And you might run into these guys. They're still running around, even on our island. And they're professing that they are Christians, but that they hold to the Old Testament law. And I say, you know what? Be careful. Because through the law comes nothing but the knowledge of sin. And the more knowledge you have of your sin, the more condemned you feel about your sin. And until you come to learn about Jesus, what Jesus did to fulfill the law, you're never going to feel free. And you'll never get the freedom to walk in this new law. Remember Jesus, when he was on earth, he told his disciples, a new commandment I give you. He didn't say, we need to pull out the old commands and let's follow them. No, he said, a new commandment I give you. My commandment is that you what? Love one another. He just kept telling them, you got to love one another. And Jesus had no trouble with saying, I get to set up a new law. A new commandment for you to follow, because I fulfilled the old one. It's done. Once it was done, it was completed. But that didn't mean that we didn't need a little instruction, a little guidance, a little something to live for. So he says, okay, I'll give you a new command. This is my commandment, that ye love one another. And what will happen? That your joy will be what? Full. You can tell people that don't, I hate to say it, but there are some sourpuss Christians out there. And you're like, hey, what's the matter with you? And nothing's wrong with me. And you're like, your joy meter's kind of low, you know, like by the minus numbers. And I don't have any problem. And that person, blah, 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 blah. And you know, the Bible says just love them. Love one another. That your joy would be full. That's Jesus' words. Jesus wants us to walk in this newness. Listen to this. We get to walk in a new law, the law of the spirit of life. Now, I want you to highlight that, because when you get approached by these folks that are under the old law, you need to tell them, listen, it's not that you live your Christian experience without a law, without God's direction. Because as soon as you say, I'm not under the law, they're like, you're one of those lawless Christians. Say, no, man, I'm under the new law. You really do need a good answer. And this is the best answer I can give you to tell those folks, is that we live under a new law. A law that was instituted by our Lord. And he said, this is his command, that we love one another. And we can read about the law right here. It's called the law of what? Not of the Old Testament. Not of Moses. Not of Leviticus. The law of the Spirit. And it's called the spirit of life. I'm under a new law. The law of the spirit of life. And they'll be like, where's that? Romans chapter 8, verse 2. Because some people don't know this is in the Bible, that there is a new law. Did you guys know about this? Some of you are like, I read this a long time ago. But some of you read right over this and didn't even spot it. That there is the law of the Spirit of life. This is of life in Christ Jesus. We get to be invited, ushered in to a newness of life. Does this give us joy when we walk in this law? This law of the Spirit of life? Now he says, the law, what it could not do, we read this verse 3, weak as it was through the flesh, God did. He sent his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh as an offering for sin, and he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but now according to what? The Spirit. By the way, the only way you're ever going to overcome your flesh is to learn to walk according to the Spirit. The flesh is too powerful to be won on the playing field of the flesh. You know, some people are like, I'm not going to do this. And then I'm like, just give it some time. You know, I mean, if you live long enough, right? You figure this out. The flesh just can't win against the flesh. But what about when you walk by the Spirit? If you walk by the Spirit, can you overcome the flesh? Yes. See, this is what Paul is leading to. Now, I'm not going to get to the whole discourse, but let me just pave the sidewalk, so to speak, to get us to the next spot we're going to be going. As we read on here, he says, for those who are according to the flesh, they set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those that are according to the Spirit, they set their minds on what? The Spirit, right. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. You know, one of the sweetest things about setting your mind on things of God's Spirit is it brings life and it brings peace. A peace that there's not really words to describe. Have any of you been having a bad trial and you're struggling with it, and God said, hey, wait, quit looking at the trial. Look at me. Pay attention. Or you're like so consumed with the trial, and you jump in your car, you're racing around, you got to go pick the kids up from school, and the radio happens to come on, and it's one of those songs that, you know, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And you're like, and you weren't even thinking about it. And the things of earth will what? Grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. I mean, all of a sudden your attention gets shifted back heavenward. And the stuff that was really distracting you gets put back in perspective. Paul is, he's got it down. He's boiled it down. He's probably had to sit with a bunch of people who they've lost their peace. There's no joy in them. And they're just all, meh, meh, meh. And he's like, so what you been thinking about? Well, I've been thinking about that person screwed me, and I'm going to get them back and revenge, and, you know, and their peace is gone. And you go, well, wait a minute. Doesn't it say vengeance is mine, says the Lord, and... What does the Lord say? I will repay? He doesn't say, you go repay. See, as Sicilians, we think we need to help God. Maybe he didn't, you know, get enough sleep or something. We could join him and help him, you know. God, you want to try to do all the vengeance? We could help. We're trained in this, right? I found Barry was at the party last night, too. I found out he's Sicilian also, so new thing to identify with. But in my upbringing, vengeance was taught to us as an art form from really young. It does come naturally, doesn't it? But with just a little bit of schooling, you can get good at it. And some of us are too proficient. And the Lord had to speak to me and say, that's not your department. Because every time I plot my own vengeance, I can tell you what happens on the inside. My peace goes away. It's a strange thing. That peace, the peace of God's Spirit, you know, that peace that really is like, oh, man. It goes out the window. And when I get consumed with thinking about the things of the flesh, how I'm going to get them back, what I'm going to do, those sweet things of the Spirit, they're gone. And the one advantage I think you get as you spend years and years of following the Lord is you start to get a little experience with this. And you, hopefully, as time goes on, you're quicker to say, I don't like not having the peace. So I'm going to repent of my flesh and go back to walking after that law of what? The Spirit of life? Yeah, I'm going to go back to that. Because as soon as I go back to what would Jesus do? In the law of the Spirit of life, I'm going to follow what he would do. What would he do? Would he take his own vengeance? Nope. Even when they smote him on the face, they beat him, they pounded those crown of thorns, did he fight back? No. I'm like, Lord, all right, I'm just do what you want me to do. And it's funny, because every time I go back to surrendering what he would want me to do, what happens to my peace? If he comes back. Remember David, when he was in sin, he's like, oh, God. Created me a clean heart, renew a right spirit, and cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. And restore unto me the joy, he said, of my salvation. His joy went away. You know, one of the things that I see happening to a lot of folks is their joy and their peace is being robbed. They're being sucked into, well, this is one of the things I run into these guys that practice that seventh-day worship thing on the Sabbath, Saturday, and they're very legalistic about it. They lose their joy. They lose their peace. Oh, yeah, they're doing the law, but not. They don't have any joy about it. And I'm like, that's the old law. You know, whenever you try to fulfill the old law, there's no joy. Because it was very specific. You blow it, you got to pay. In the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, is there joy? Is there peace? That's what you've been invited. Is there condemnation for your sin? None. Talk about something to make us rejoice. Man, we can really jump for joy. I have nothing. God looks at me and says, I don't condemn you for anything. Now, if you don't know that, there are some people that don't know that that's what Christ has offered. Complete, complete forgiveness of our sins. He will never look at you and go, I forgive you for almost all of them, but that one was really bad. Does Jesus do that? No. He goes, you're forgiven. Done. It's all. And what happens to your joy when you... We call that the joy of our what? Salvation. Man, you saved me. From all that junk, you freed me. You are really cool. This is where we get to rejoice. Now, Paul is laying it out so that we would now know we're going to start to walk after a new law. The law of the life of the Spirit. So I want you to just remember this for next week when we continue. Now, we're going to do one more study in Romans next week. It's the 18th of December next week. And then the following week is Christmas. So the following week we'll have a Christmas message. But for this coming up, I want to do the rest of Romans 8 with you. Okay, and it's not really that I could put a break right where we are, but I can pick up from here where we are for you next week. So if you could just keep this in mind, what law are we under? The law of the Spirit of what? Life in Christ Jesus. You are under a new law. Not the old one, the new one. And the new one has like one rule. Love one another. It's pretty hard. So this Jesus boiled it down. I like Jesus. He makes everything simpler. Now, before we close, we have a whole group of Koreans going on outreach from YWAM that have blessed us with a lot of serving hands at the food table. And would you guys mind if we lay hands on them? I'd like to pray over them before they go. Dave, would you come up, and Aaron and a couple of the brothers. Could I have all the Korean contingent come right up here in the front? And We're going to miss these guys as they have really been a blessing to doing our homeless feeding. And I'm going to pray that we get at least half of them back after. Is that okay? All? Yeah, let's take them all. 100%. Would you guys mind gather around? Let's lay hands on these guys as they're going to go. When do you leave for outreach?
Different times.
Different times? Where are you guys going? I want to hear. Some of you guys are in the mainland. You're going to go? These guys are going to go witness to our cousins over there. No. Where are you going?
Guatemala, Costa Rica, Peru.
Okay, Guatemala, Costa Rica, and Peru. And you? Where are you going? Did you hear that? Israel, Jordan, Turkey, and Greece. Anyone else going somewhere different? Haiti and Dominican Republic? Okay. So we have some. And you?
England, France, Italy, Poland.
England, France, Poland? Okay.
Wow.
They're going all over. So we're going to pray for them because these guys are going to be lights to all the nations. And we want to ask that God would be with them and guard them. And Father, we thank you for these dear brothers and sisters and their servants' hearts that you have put into these people. And we thank you, Lord, as they're going to go to outreaches to different corners of our globe, Lord, we just ask that you would use them as bright lights for your gospel. We ask for protection, for angels to guard them as they travel, your spirit, Lord, to empower them and to fill them, Lord, with your discernment, your mercy, your words of knowledge, whatever they might need, Lord, in each circumstance that they're going to face. We just ask that you would give them a full equipping of those things from your Holy Spirit. And we pray this together, Lord, as they go from us. We just so grateful for the time we got to spend together. And we just thank you for them. Pray that you bring them back to us safely when they complete their mission work. In Jesus' name we ask this. And everyone that agreed with me said?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're so grateful for this group. We are very grateful for you. And what a blessing. Look how many missionaries from little. What a. Oh, man. Okay, send us more Koreans because. They're trying to keep them. We're selfish. Oh, well, you know what? It's a great thing that we have this. I feel like I got the privilege to preach at a post where God brings me a lot of people on fire for him, ready to go serve the Lord in the mission field. And I get just a few weeks of their lives to help hopefully equip them with something from his spirit that they need for their walk. And you know, there's not one message that I've heard that doesn't come in handy at some point. And God knows how to bring those things back. So I pray he bring back to your remembrance those things. And if you get lonely and miss us, you just click on the YouTube and you watch one of the videos and you see this. And you'll, the God's Spirit. You know, Mary's was in Thailand 4 years. And she's back with us. She's a little what do you call, culture shock. She is. After 4 years, milk in Thailand is like a quarter or something, a gallon. And she's just like, she said, I couldn't even handle it. I went in a store, I ran out. And it's just so expensive back in home. And she's from here, but it's, you know, 4 years is long enough that it changes, you know, your perspective. So we need to keep her in prayer and keep our missionaries in prayer. Keep these guys in prayer. You know, if they come to your mind, please, lift them up to the Lord. You know, Jesus said, my Father's house is a house of what? Prayer for all nations. So we want to be a people that continue to lift them up in prayer. And would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song. Send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.